today we are going to talk about postmenopausal bleeding. Okay. आज का फॉर्मेट सिर्फ इतना सा बदला है कि मैंने आपके आने से पहले डिस्कशन की कि एक दो रिक्वेस्ट थी कि ये अंग्रेज़ी में होना चाहिए, कि मैंने कहा चलो हम अंग्रेज़ी कोशिश करके देख लेते हैं, तो कमज़ोर लेकिन फिर भी कोशिश कर लेनी चाहिए. सो नेक्स्ट फ्यू क्लासेस आई विल टेक इन इंग्लिश, विल स्पीक इंग्लिश एंड बिकॉज इट्स ए टेक्निकल सेशन सो हार्डली मैटर्स वेदर वी स्पीक इंग्लिश और उर्दू बिकॉज टेक्निकल टर्मिनोलॉजी दे रियली कन्वे द मैसेज, दे कन्वे द मैसेज, बट वी विल ट्राई दिस एंड लेट्स सी हाउ दिस फॉर्मेट गोज. ऊंचा बोलिए ताकि उसमें थे.
My patient, Mrs. Shaida Naseem, wife of Mr. Naseem, 65 year of age, educated till 5th grade. She is housewife, resident of Wadu village near Gujranwala. Married for last 40 year, para 5 plus 0, 2 alive issue, all spontaneous vaginal delivery. Last child birth was 30 year back. She is menopausal for last 15 year. Admitted through outpatient department of Sir Gangaram Hospital on 10th of December 2018 with a complaint of postmenopausal bleeding 2 years back. Vaginal discharge for last 3 years.
How many days back?
2 years back.
2 years back.
Yes. My patient had a natural menopause for last 15 years. Previously, she remained asymptomatic. 2 years back, she had a complaint of postmenopausal bleeding. It was spontaneous in onset. The bleeding was moderate in amount. She used to soak 1 to 2 pads per day, and the bleeding lasted for about 1 month. It was followed by bleeding in followed by bleeding-free interval of 1 month, and then there is PV spotting for about 15 days. It was unprovoked, not associated with coitus or any trauma. There is no history of something coming out of vagina, no history of abdominal pain and distension, any urinary and bowel complaint. There is no history of anorexia, weight loss, bony pain, no personal and family history of breast, colorectal, endometrial and ovarian malignancy. There is no history of chronic liver disease, heat and cold intolerance, insomnia, somnolence, no history of hot flashes, night sweat, vaginal dryness, and there is no history of any intake of homeopathic, allopathic and hormonal medication. For this complaint, she visited a local doctor where her pelvic ultrasound was done. The report of that ultrasound was not known to the patient. At that time, pap smear endometrial sampling was not done and no treatment is offered to the patient. Now, for the last 3 months, she had a complaint of vaginal discharge. The discharge was small in amount, thick in consistency, white in color.
Just a minute. You mean 2 years ago she had these symptoms? Yes. For 2 months practically. Yes. Yes. And after that she was all right?
Yes sir, she remained she had two episodes of postmenopausal bleeding 2 years back.
That's what? Yes. for 2 months.
Hmm. After that she remained
she had no more bleeding for 22 months.
Yes sir. And now she presented with complaint of PV discharge. Patient had a complaint of vaginal discharge for last 3 months. The discharge was small in amount, thick in consistency, white in color, foul smelling. It was not associated with itching and is not blood stained. There is no history of abdominal pain, fever and any instrumentation. She went to local doctor where she prescribed some medicine. The name of that medicine is not known to the patient. And her complaints didn't settle with that medicine. She had a complaint of shortness of breath. She had a complaint of lethargy, generalized body weakness, shortness of breath and palpitation. It was not associated with chest pain or cough and expectoration. Now she is referred to Sir Gangaram Hospital for further evaluation. Today is her 10th post-admission day. Her blood and urine tests were done. Pelvic ultrasound was also carried out, and according to the patient, she was told that there is some pathology, there is some uterine pathology. Her endometrial sampling was planned, and during her workup, her HP was found to be low. It was 8.3 gram per deciliter. She was asked to arrange blood, and one unit of blood was transfused in the ward, and it remained uneventful. The rest of the management plan is not discussed with the patient.
Good. Shall we skip other histories? She, some of you arrived late. She is para 5, last childbirth was 30 years ago, and she had menopause 15 years ago. But 2 years after menopause, she had post-menopausal bleeding, or shall we call it, she had two episodes of bleeding, without naming it post-menopausal. She had two episodes of bleeding, but that too was 2 years ago.
2 years back.
2 years ago.
It was 13 years after her menopause.
2 years ago or 13 years after. But after that she was fine. Recently she had foul-smelling discharge, which was treated by some local doctor, and oral treatment.
Yes.
Oral treatment was given to her, and with that she felt relieved of the discharge. Discharge improved. So the salient features of this patient are, one, her age, 65 years of age. Two, that she had menopause 15 years ago. And her parity, she is para 5. And after 2 years, she had two episodes of bleeding, but after that, she has been all right. And recently, this discharge. So, with this history, any criticism of this history? Anything? If you don't say, I'll say the things which you should have added, that when she had that bleeding 13 years ago, 2 years ago, after 13 years, did she have any medication? Did she have, it should be said so, that prior to that bleeding, she did not have any medication, which means it could, the commonest cause is that patient goes to a GP with the complaints of like insomnia, hot flushes, something, which general practitioner translates into post-menopausal symptoms, and he prescribes estrogens or hormones. With that, the symptoms improve, no doubt. But when she stops the treatment, the patient gets bleeding. Remember, this is the commonest cause of post-menopausal bleeding in general population. General population. So if a patient comes to you with this complaint, you must add to your history, there is no history of intake of any drugs or medicine prior to this bleeding. Second thing is, that recently she had this episode, not so recent, but 2 years ago, and now vaginal discharge. The lady did mention that her hemoglobin is low, she is short of breath, general aches and pains. But remember, if we are thinking in terms of malignancy, which we should, in all cases of postmenopausal bleeding, if we are thinking of any malignancy, then generally one of the important signs of malignancy, which is not causing any symptoms, is weight loss. Weight loss. If a patient in that age group suddenly starts losing weight without going on special diet or anything, you must think of malignancy. There are no symptoms. This is so unfortunate that almost all malignancies, they are initially asymptomatic. There is no pain, no fever, nothing associated with malignancy. Nothing associated with malignancy. It's so unfortunate, because if the early malignancy had caused pain, had caused fever, as and all infections do, then the detection would have been easier. It would have been early. Don't you listen to this story that even lady doctors had suddenly felt a lump which was stage 2, 3, 4, which should not happen. Should not happen. Nothing to do with this case. I can say I order all of you, please, 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 on first of every month, you will do self-palpation of breast. After all, what's wrong with this? When you go to the bathroom, your room is locked. So instead of feeling your breast, standing in front of the mirror, it would take a minute or two. But if you do this, then, God forbid, if there is any lump or anything, you will detect it early. After all, CA breast, doesn't it happen to the lay doctors? Doesn't it happen to of your age patients? It happens. So, this is just a sideline of this class that I honestly feel is so strongly. If I ask you how many of you do it, perhaps very few of you will raise hands. I don't ask you to raise hands, but very few of you will do that. So, do that. So, in this case, we come back because we suspect malignancy. So, in this, you must add that there's no history of weight loss. Now we come to the fact that her hemoglobin is low, for which she was transfused. Her hemoglobin was perhaps 8 gram per cent. If you have a patient, her hemoglobin is 8 gram per cent, and she is symptomatic. She is short of breath, and she can't do the household work, or can't walk about. Yes, transfuse. But, which she didn't say, most important, before you say her hemoglobin was 8 gram and she was transfused, in one breath, in between add, her hemoglobin was 8 grams, the type of anemia was diagnosed or was not diagnosed. Although we know that anemia in our society, 90% is iron deficiency or deficiency anemia, dietary deficiencies. But still, those 10% which are not due to dietary deficiency, due to some other reasons, you must make a correct diagnosis and then treat that. We just take it for granted, 8 gram iron deficiency. Although this patient doesn't give any history of bleeding. He didn't give any history of bleeding. That 2 years ago, bleeding would not cause anemia of today.
Yes, sir.
So, whenever, this is for general discussion, whenever you have a patient Her hemoglobin is low. In history, she has given this. Always say her anemia was diagnosed by some laboratory tests or it was not diagnosed. Because that's how you should be treating your patients. Not like this. 8 gram, give her blood. Yes, her blood was justified, I would say, because she was asymptomatic. She was symptomatic. So to correct her symptoms, shortness of breath, etc., she was given 1 bag of blood, which possibly relieved her symptoms. Although 1 bag would raise hemoglobin by only 1 gram per cent. 1 gram per cent. So this is general description. And let's go on to the physical examination. We'll skip other histories, past history, family history, this one.
65-year-old lady, well-oriented.
Just a minute. But during the history, she did mention very important factor that there's no history of breast, colon, or ovarian cancer. Because you know the syndrome which links these four cancers together. It was mentioned. It is important. And similarly, it should be mentioned in family history as well.
65-year-old lady, well oriented with time, space and person, with a height of about 5 feet 2 inches and weight 72 kg, making her BMI 27 kg per meter square. Her pulse is 100 beat per minute, good volume, regular rhythm. Blood pressure was 140 by 100 millimeter of mercury. Temperature was 98.6 Fahrenheit, and respiratory rate is 20 breath per minute.
I would say all these TPR kind of thing, they are relevant in this patient because she was short of breath. But generally speaking, if patient is healthy, sitting comfortably, which you normally say, in them out description of pulse, respiration rate, temperature is not necessary. Is not necessary, but here it becomes relevant.
She is pale, there is no jaundice, colonicia, leukonychia, clubbing, pedal edema. Her oral dental hygiene is satisfactory and thyroid is not enlarged. All accessible lymph nodes are not palpable. Bilateral breast is normal looking with normal areola and nipple complex, and no lump is felt in all four quadrants of the breast. Normal vesicular breathing with no eddy sound. First and second heart sound is audible. On inspection, the abdomen is flabby with central inverted umbilicus. There is no visible scar mark and hernia orifice are intact. A mass corresponding to 16 week size of gestation with a smooth surface, soft in consistency, well-defined margin, non-tender, and with restricted mobility and lower limit is not reachable. Percussion node is dull over the mass while it is resonant in the flank. There is no ascite, no visceromegaly, and inguinal lymph nodes are not palpable.
Don't say no ascites. Just describe how you tested. Don't say no ascites. That you are asking for trouble. Trouble in the sense, then immediately discussion will move on to what are the causes of ascites. In that liver and other congestive heart failure, so many things come in which are irrelevant to our discussion. You will waste your time in that. It will not be useful. But say signs. No dullness in the flanks. And when there is no dullness, there is no shifting dullness. So though there is no dullness in the flanks, full stop. Full stop. Okay.
Well, sir, on vulva is normal looking. Vaginal wall and cervix is also normal looking. Cervix is mid position. and there is a whitish mucoid discharge coming out of the os. However, there is no bleeding at time of examination. Uterus is corresponding to 16 week size, regularly in large, soft in consistency, and mobile, non-tender. However, there is a fullness felt in the right fornix.
Very good. Where do you come from?
Sir, I'm from Gangaram Hospital.
Oh, you changed my opinion. Very good. Which unit?
Sir,
so,
unit 3,
sir. You were graduate of Gangaram?
Yeah.
Mashallah. Very good. So, anyway, it's a good history. Good history. Just a few minor things. Vulva is healthy, and vulva, you said, is healthy. Vulva in a postmenopause is atrophic. But healthy is, will go. It means healthy for that age. Healthy for that age. So it doesn't matter. But if you have said atrophic, it would have been more specific thing. Closer to reality thing. That vulva is healthy, then vaginal walls, you said, is on inspection. Add description of cervix a little more, because until you describe the mass abdomen, I mean, as you say the history, we start thinking of differential diagnosis. I would say, let's forget about the mass in this patient. Forget it. Rest of the history, a patient 65 and para 5 had episodes of postmenopausal bleeding, now foul smelling discharge. I would imagine CA cervix comes up high on the list. If not number one, at least number two. At least number two. But with the description of mass 16 week size, then we relegate CA cervix to number three or number four place. That's how you keep thinking about differential diagnosis. Initially, I would say, just from history, where we don't know the mass abdomen, I would put CA cervix in this patient as number two. Number two, because the peak incidence of CA cervix is 45 to 55. This patient is 10 years beyond. That's why it is number two. If it was the patient who was between 45 and 55, para 5, I would put CA cervix as number one. And CA endometrium is 10 years later. CA endometrium is 10 years later. So 45 to 55 is CA cervix peak. 55 to 65 is CA endometrium peak. When I say peak and peak, it doesn't mean the other age is excluded. CA cervix can happen in a very young patient, in 20s, 30s. And CA endometrium can happen earlier than 55, of course. Of course. So that way we keep juggling our differential diagnosis as we proceed. When we started, CA cervix was top. Para 5, postmenopausal bleed, and first thing which comes to your mind, never had pap smear and diagnosis of CA cervix. But as we proceed, then CA cervix become number two. Then, because of the age and things, then as we move further, it goes down. But still, because CA cervix is in consideration, So when we describe cervix, she did say no bleed. The cervix did not bleed on touch or something like that. She mentioned that. But still, health of the cervix should be described a little more. Both lips of the cervix look healthy. There is no ectopy or any ulcerative lesion. And during examination, cervix is mobile, moving. Because in advanced CA cervix, it gets fixed because of infiltration of the growth into the parametrium. So a little more description should remain there. Although I would say, until and unless you have made a definitive diagnosis, CA cervix should remain in spite of the fact that it looks healthy. This is an important message of the day. In spite of the fact, in a postmenopausal patient bleeding, if cervix looks healthy, it doesn't exclude CA cervix. Because it could be from the cervical canal as well. Cervical canal. In that case, the lips of the cervix will look healthy. So we'll keep that diagnosis. We'll not exclude it. We'll not throw it out. Because cervix looks healthy, impossible. That is not CA cervix. Still, we'll take pap smear if it had not been done. And that pap smear will be during your first examination, during this examination. And the candidate should say, the cervix looks healthy, but still I will take pap smear. But then you should, if at all the examiner stops you, ask about pap smear and various stages and ask us and things like that, then you should be ready to answer that. Okay. All right. So this is here is a patient, 16 weeks mass, cervix looks healthy, and complains of foul smelling discharge, which responded to some oral treatment. This is the description of the patient, isn't it? Okay, what do you think she has?
Sir, regarding this patient.
One more. She said, on bimanual examination, it is uterine mass which is 16 week size. Slight improvement in your description. On bimanual examination, the uterus is attached to the mass which is further description is as it is, as it was given, which means, you know, if there's ovarian tumor of 16 week size lying in the pelvis, and so many times it's difficult to separate uterus from that mass. Uterus could be normal, but adherent to the mass, particularly chocolate cysts. When you examine them, if there's a large chocolate cyst, and then there's so many adhesions inside the pelvis, you can't separate uterus from the mass. So by bimanual examination, you can't be too sure whether the mass is uterine or it is the uterus which is attached to some other mass, involved in that mass, which could well be ovarian, paravarian, or any other thing. Okay, good history. I have already complimented you on that.
Sir, while examining this patient, I feel, sir, there is a in the right iliac fossa and the lumbar region, I feel some fullness while examining that. But sir, that mass was not well defined, and sir, I on deep palpation I see that there is a fullness in the right iliac fossa. Sir, I want to ask you, if I feel like this, so in examination, when you are not sure about that, that mass is not, in ovarian mass, they are more particularly they are palpable or. Sir, हमने फिर वो चीज़ mention करनी है कि I have a query about this कि वो
very from examination point of view very important question that on abdominal examination she felt a mass which was 16 week size visible non tender etc. So good description was given of that mass. Now in addition to that she suspects on examination there's suspicion whether there is separate mass in right iliac fossa, which perhaps is there or it may not be there. Vague kind of feeling.
Vague
kind of feeling. Skip it. Keep it focused on to that mass, 16 week size. It'll make your life easy. Because when you say maybe, may not be, that differential diagnosis of mass in right iliac fossa, there are 104 causes of that. You go back, read surgery book, Bailey and Love or anything. Differential diagnosis of appendix, which makes a mass as well. Innumerable things. Ectopic kidney, which you don't think of normally. Then ovarian, then para-ovarian, then lymph nodes, then bony masses, then innumerable. So you will waste your time in differentiating that. Whereas the main diagnosis of that mass 16 weeks will go into the background and the bell will go, you have not dealt with the mass. In any gynae patient, whatever the diagnosis, remember this. At the end of the discussion, you should have given full treatment, if need be, medical, surgical, and sent the patient home. Then you pass. If you are halfway through investigation, if you are halfway through treatment part, then you need not wait for the result, you should know the result. Come back after 6 months. So keep the discussion going. Don't get stuck in the side lanes. So if there is just the feeling, vaguely feeling, don't sort of highlight it. We have highlighted this man. Okay, what will you do?
Sir, I want to discuss. Shall I tell about the ultrasound report of this?
Of course. So then we come to investigations. So she has moved on to ultrasound. We'll do hematological investigations, urinary, and all that. And then we come to ultrasound, okay? And of course, we'll take X-ray chest.
Yes, sir. Sir, as this patient is anemic and she is hypertensive, so sir, I will also go for echocardiography because she is hypertensive for last 10 years and she is anemic as well. So, sir, shall I go for echocardiography?
No. This is second tip of the day. If your patient is diabetic, hypertensive, congestive cardiac failure, heart disease, any metabolic disease, anything, during investigation, I'll do relevant investigations for heart disease. Full stop. only then you will send the patient home after treatment, because we are focusing on to the treatment of this mass. Say she is diabetic, I will look at her diabetes chart and advise or consult multidisciplinary thing, the appropriate consultant, full stop. Don't go into detail and the six line chart, this and that, correction of, no. Then you're wasting your time, because you're not getting a credit for that description. You will get credit only if you finish treatment of this mass before the bell goes. Before the bell goes. So we'll do investigations, but we'll do relevant investigation of her anemia. Need not go into details. Details, if examiner stops you, what investigation you will, of course, then we will say that. Then you will say, I'll do blood film, then microcytic, whatever the way.
Sir, on ultrasound report, 14 into 8 centimeter, the uterine dimension, 14 into 8 centimeter distended endometrial cavity with heterogeneous material, 11 into 5.6 centimeter and transitional zone is not visible. They didn't mention the endometrial thickness. On the right, in right iliac fossa in the lumbar region, there is 6 into 10 centimeter mass, and sir, unhone query dali hui thi omental ki.
Now, if ultrasound says there's a mass, examiner asks you, didn't you feel that mass? You weren't very sure. You weren't very sure about it. So you can say, madam, because of that 16 weeks mass lying there, I could not palpate properly, because 16 weeks mass will lift the abdominal wall up.
Yes, sir.
And keep the abdominal wall away from that small mass. So it's quite fair. Don't get upset about it. That she says, oh, why didn't you feel that mass? So, madam, because of the large mass, small mass was missed. Because of the large, small was missed. Okay. Then the ultrasound says there's uterine cavity filled with some mass, and in addition, there is a mass in the right leg fossa.
Yes.
Okay.
Sir, I have CT scan report as well. Sir, shall I discuss
this? Yeah, sure. No, will you ask for CT in this
case? No, sir. In this case, I will not go for CT, I will go for MRI.
You will go. Why have you chosen MRI?
Sir, because MRI has more sensitivity to pick up the soft tissue disease like myometrial invasion, cervical involvement, paramecium involvement, and as well as the lymph node.
This is very important. This is, because now in this patient, if at all there is a mass in the uterine cavity, most likely is endometrial carcinoma. A polypoidal endometrial carcinoma. If it is endometrial carcinoma, then before you go into surgical staging or laparotomy, seek help as much as possible to find out the stage. And MRI gives you enlargement of lymph nodes. So wherever you feel enlargement of lymph nodes is very important in management, then MRI should be carried out, because it gives you extension and lymph node enlargement. Good.
Sir, on CT, CT report
bata. But she had CT anyway.
Yes,
the CT report says?
The uterine mass 12 into 8 into 8 centimeter with 10 in into 7 centimeter caesar with myometrial invasion. There are peritoneal deposits at the multiple areas, sir. At the CT report, there is a bilateral inguinal lymph node enlarged.
So, what do you think is this?
सर स्टेज 4 बनती है सर।
स्टेज 4 एंडोमेट्रियल कार्सिनोमा
4D बनती है सर इन्वाइनल
4D ए बी सी डी
बी
अच्छा बी ए बी सी डी तो 4B एनीवे एज फार एज पॉसिबल दैट मीन So how will you manage this patient? Because now we have got 10 minutes
First
more.
First of all, I will consult the patient regarding the diagnosis. And sir, I have, sir, pehle to main investigations mangungi after discussing about the endometrial sampling report, histopathology report and MRI report. Then
no, they have, endometrial sampling has not been done.
Yes, sir. Sir, it is done, but report is awaited. It is done in the
report. Okay.
Sir, after first of all, I want to.
If it was not done,
then I will plan for endometrial sampling first. Yeah. After building up her HB and sir BP control with collaboration with physician. Mm-hmm. First of all, I will optimize her health and then I.
Just a minute. But just for a short while, we decide. Here is a patient, 16 week size. Which has got a polypoidal growth inside the uterus. We don't have other CT or MRI reports of extension, metastasis, lymph node, anything. We don't have. Now, if this is a patient with no metastasis, no ascites, nothing, then same patient, how will you treat this?
Sir, first of all, I need certain investigation to confirm my diagnosis.
You will need?
Certain investigation to confirm my diagnosis. Huh? Sir, I need a pelvic abdominal pelvic ultrasound.
That shows that
yes,
must.
I will go for, sir, after optimizing her health, her HP level, her controlling her BP, I will go for endometrial sampling.
Everybody agrees. Everybody agrees?
Yes.
No difference over. Good. What I wanted to say, I mean, when they are meds and things, then the story might become different. If there is only endometrial or ultrasound mass in the uterine cavity, recently there has been no bleeding. No bleeding.
Yes.
So don't label this as endometrial carcinoma. We must do endometrial biopsy. Sampling or biopsy, I would say use the word biopsy more. Because it could well be that it was a fibroid which was lying there for ages. Now, possibly it got infected, polypoidal mass. And that infected fibroid caused purulent or foul-smelling discharge. Now, in this patient, we will not be doing justice to the patient on making correct diagnosis if we label her without biopsy a case of endometrial carcinoma. So, if there are no mets, nothing, and there is a mass in the uterine cavity, patient 65 years of age, whether she had bleeding or no bleeding or any symptoms or no symptoms, we'll do biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. One odd example could be that patient comes to you, you find in 16 weeks mass in the lower abdomen. She has no complaints about it. Actually, this patient has no complaints about this. 16 weeks before ultrasound, 16 weeks mass in lower abdomen, no complaints. What will be your first diagnosis? First diagnosis in this patient, if there are no symptoms at all, will be fibroids. Fibroids are the commonest tumors in the pelvis. They can lie there asymptomatic. As a matter of fact, all of us know that they regress in size after menopause. So generally speaking, if they have not caused any symptoms, fibroids could be asymptomatic. Or I would say, use the word, are asymptomatic, generally speaking. Generally speaking, not all fibroids cause symptoms. So here's a patient, 65 years of age, had fibroids all her life. They never bothered her, and as I said earlier, they regressed in size. And so when you examine her abdomen first time, there's 16 weeks mass lying there. So our first diagnosis is fibroid, clinical diagnosis. Then our second diagnosis would be ovarian mass, ovarian tumor. Third diagnosis will be endometrial carcinoma, because endometrial carcinoma normally doesn't cause enlargement of the uterus to 16 weeks. नहीं होता ना तो भी मैंने कहा ना जस्ट ऑन एब्डोमिनल एग्जामिनेशन दिस विल बी द सीक्वेंस ऑफ अवर डायग्नोस आफ्टर डायग्नोसिस आर फोर और फाइव लिमिटेड लिस्ट यू नो इफ समबडी इज रनिंग Pyrexia of uncertain origin, PUO. There are more than 100 causes of that. Fever could be from top to toe, anything. Anything. We are lucky, our specialty. I always tell my colleagues, I am lucky. When a patient comes to us, I have to sort of sift four or five diagnoses. Their order can be changed, but our list is very limited, so easy to make a diagnosis. You don't need too much, shall I say, gray matter to make a diagnosis. Physicians need a lot of knowledge, and here we don't. We survive with limited knowledge as well. Never. So if there's a mass abdomen, 65 years of age, and we have not reached ultrasound as yet, and the diagnosis number one would be fibroid, number two will be ovarian, and number three will be only then.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Sir, if the mass is central and we cannot separately palpable it from the uterus, can we say that it is uterine mass?
Ovarian mass.
Of course, of course.
So but
just a minute, just a minute. Ovarian mass are generally cystic. They are smooth. And maybe they are mobile or not. But fibroids or uterine masses are generally nodular. They are firm in consistency. Both are non-tender. Both are non-tender. And when you feel it attached to the uterus, then fibroid will be number one diagnosis. Ovarian tumor will remain second diagnosis. You cannot, just because you feel mass is central, so it must be uterine, exclude. Because, you know, any patient, this is 65 is more special patient than any patient who has a mass lower abdomen. It's our moral responsibility to make sure it is not ovarian, or especially it is not ovarian malignancy. Because it's so important. Man, in your practice or in your family or friends, don't you see young patients having ovarian cancer?
Sir,
And you go to Shaukat Khan Hospital, cancer hospital, there are a lot of young women going treatment for ovarian cancer. So that should remain on the list. Even if it is central, whatever the consistency and everything you feel, still, because of those clinical features, you can shift them one or two, but keep them on the list. And same in the examination, keep them in the discussion. Very important.
Sir, I want to ask you, endometrial carcinoma mein pyometra may be given. Will it be the cause of enlarged uterus?
16 weeks. Not so common. And generally speaking, pyometra develops more commonly in cancer patients. When cancer spreads in the cavity, blocks the internal os, then there is nothing to let out. So accumulation of pus or anything, it gives that. But without...
Will it cause the enlargement of the uterus size to 16
weeks, a kind of a mass, which when we say chocolate cyst cannot be 16 weeks. Because chocolate cysts are generally in the pelvis, but some do. A borderline growth. If you ask me 22 weeks, 36 weeks, yes, no. Answer is no.
I asked the same question from a professor and she began to say that I haven't seen such a mass with the endometrial carcinoma complicated by pyometra.
Just a minute. When anybody says with his or her experience, more her, with her experience, she has never seen this, it shuts up discussion. Don't argue, but it proves ignorance. Anybody saying, in my 50 years of clinic, I can say that, I've been practicing 50 years. In my 50 years experience, I've never seen pyometra of 16 weeks size. In 16 weeks. Keep quiet. Because this sends a message that discussion is stopped, sealed. By the same time, remember this. One individual's experience is not the total story. Yes, she's right. I am right in saying I've never seen. But this is not the total history. History is too vast. So in any discussion, when somebody says, in my experience, after that, you shut up. Say discussion is finished. Madam, your experience is vast more than anybody else's, so I accept it. Full stop. But 16 weeks is not too big.
Yes.
16 weeks is not too big. I said if you go beyond 22 and things like that, yes. 16 weeks is just borderline. With little urine in the bladder, 12 weeks becomes 16 weeks. So let's not enter into this minor discussion.
I want to ask that, okay, while asking the investigation from the examiner, I will go for tumor marker for ovarian malignancy.
In this patient?
In this patient.
If the cavity is ultrasound and all that.
They didn't give me the ultrasound report.
Why shouldn't they?
Sir, they gave on the second session of discussion, while discussing the first session, will I go for...
You say proviso, that I'll do first ultrasound. If the uterus is normal or the cavity is not as you have described, then a possibility. First, we are lucky. We are extreme, you people especially are lucky. You know, in my days, one has to make a pelvic examination to differentiate between uterine mass, ovarian mass, and things like that, early pregnancy diagnosis, pulsation, softness of the uterus, all those features were very important. But now, pelvic examination is not necessary. Even Royal College guidelines says intimate examination is not necessary always. Because ultrasound tells you much better, much more than your pelvic examination could. So hence, before ultrasound, you say that 16 weeks mass, I like to differentiate between uterine and ovarian. And if it is ovarian, then I'll do tumor markers of the ovarian tumors. Various markers you should know for epithelial tumors, for other chorionic tumors and things like that, and dysgerminomas. So, but once you have ultrasound, in this patient we have ultrasound, then to say I'll do tumor markers,
yes,
I think that you're getting lost then. You're not focusing on management of this patient. Because I told you, you have to treat the patient and home. So if we get that, in addition to the 16 weeks mass, there's a mass on the right side, which could be ovarian tumor. Hence, I'll do CA125, this. So you will get lost into that. Which tumor markers you will like to do? What do they show? Which tumors they show? The bell will go and the mass, 16 weeks mass, will still there in the abdomen, so you fail. You have to remove it. In other words, means you have to treat that mass. So keep it focused. So here is a mass and MRI shows these things. How will you treat this patient?
Multidisciplinary approach in which, I involve the anesthetist, radiologist, histopathologist, clinical oncologist, and gynecological oncologist, and the general gynecologist as well. Then I will take the anesthesia fitness. For that, I require certain investigations, which include LFTs, RF.
For fitness of?
Yes, sir, fitness of the
patient.
Surgery. Huh. Then I have blood arrangement, at least 2 units of blood is arranged before surgery, and then I will take the detailed consent of the procedure, which include the whole explanation of the detail of the procedure, the additional intervention take place during the procedure, the mode of the anesthesia, the duration of the anesthesia, the complication associated with that procedure, and the need of radiotherapy.
Good. But order should be changed. When I asked her how will you treat this patient, she said it must multidisciplinary approach, described in detail, all specialists participating in that. And then she said, I'll counsel my patient, etc., etc. I'll just change the order. Once you made the final diagnosis, first thing which you should do before you arrange the team, you have arranged all the team, multidisciplinary, urologist, general surgeon, physician, anesthesiologist, this and that. You have done that, 2 bottles of blood, etc., etc. And then you tell the patient and her relative say, no surgery. We don't want surgery. Then all your arrangements fail. So first thing, order should be correct, that after the diagnosis is made, I'll counsel my patient about the diagnosis, stage of the disease, treatment possibilities, and their complications. See, in 4 sentences, rather 4 words, I have described everything which your examiner wants you to say. I'll counsel my patient, remember this, for all your patients. I'll counsel my patient, after the diagnosis is made, don't say treatment first and then counsel. Say counsel first. I'll counsel my patient about the diagnosis, stage of the disease, and its treatment possibilities and their complications. And complications. You must mention those. For example, surgery, complications are immense. Almost all complications in the book can happen during surgery and post-op in this advanced stage. Because you'll be doing a mastectomy, you'll be doing, you don't know whether tumor has spread into the parametrium or not, and all these things. So complication, the word complications of surgery must be mentioned. Irrespective, simple hysterectomy. A young patient, 35, 40 years of age, multiple fibroids, nothing abnormal about it, you go for myomectomy or hysterectomy according to parity. So I'll, for a first sentence, I'll counsel my patient about the diagnosis that fibroid is a benign disease. Then is treatment. In, for you, we feel myomectomy is best or hysterectomy is best. If hysterectomy, then laparoscopic hysterectomy, TAH or whatever you're going to do, that and its complications possible in this place, more so. So you will counsel your patient and then prepare the team. Now just describe, the patient is under anesthesia, clean drape, proceed.
Sir, I will open the patient by the inframbrachial vertical incision. Then I will take the peritoneal washing. After opening the
peritoneum.
Yes, sir. If there is a CITES present, a CITE fluid or peritoneal washing for cytology. Then I will inspect I will inspect the whole abdomen cavity, which the uterus, the bilateral tubes, and the OD, and the whole abdomen in an anti-clockwise direction, starting from the cecum, ascending colon, the paracolic gutters, the right hepatic flex.
In such detail, you may not go. I would like to advise all of you that if you are doing laparotomy for ovarian mass or any malignancy, ovarian mass, most common malignancy we face, or any malignancy, as the lady has mentioned, first thing after opening the abdomen, collection of fluid for cytology. We don't say this. This is most important. And then next thing is assessment of the disease or evaluation of the disease. In other words, kind of staging of the disease, how far it has spread. Instead of going into paracolic, you know, that save your time. For me, 8 to 9 is my time, it's already 9:10. So see how the time flies in examination as well. It's 9:10, we have not reached, we have not completed surgical treatment. It has to be followed by radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and follow-up.
Respect the whole abdominal cavity, then I will go into the stage the disease, and according to the stage of the disease, I will do the total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral self-oophorectomy, and it depends upon the histopathological report. If it is type 1 tumor, then I will go for THBSO, and if it is type 2 endometrial carcinoma, which includes the pelvis.
But here, metastases are there.
Yes, sir, already was staged.
So I'll do partial mastectomy as well.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, see the bold state. In this patient, the MRI report shows that this disease has spread into the omentum.
So then I will go for debulking surgery, cytoreductive surgery.
That's better word, debulking the tumor and omentectomy. Mm-hmm. The omentum challenge. You have done this. Then?
Sir, lymph nodes ke bhi hum
lenge. You will palpate lymph nodes,
yes,
and see whether they are truly enlarged, because MRI has said.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Then, sir, after surgery, then I will counsel the patient regarding the detail of the procedure and the complication associated with it. Then, depending upon the histopathological report, I'm going to further management plan will depend upon that. And in most of the cases, radiotherapy, post-operative radiotherapy is done. And I will counsel the patient regarding the follow-up, sir, 4 monthly for the first 2 years and then 6 monthly for next 5 years.
Good, good, very good. And so in this patient, we'll do laparotomy, as the lady has described, with cytology and maximum removal of the malignancy as far as possible kind of thing. She has a TH, BSO, and partial mastectomy and lymph node if they can be easily accessed and all that. And here, because you're doing such extensive surgery, so refer to post-operative period a little bit at least. That after such extensive surgery, the patient needs intensive post-operative care. It gives good impression to your examiner that you are a concerned doctor. It's not surgery is done, now it's my responsibility is finished, no more. No, not like this. She will need intensive post-operative care, especially for bladder, for rectum, and also her hydration, nutrition, in the immediate post-operative period, and also pain. I should have said pain first. Pain relief is important part of post-operative care. We forget about it. We think it is a routine thing. It is not routine. It should be on order. Your order should be there. Give her pain relief by epidural, by pethidine, morphine, whatever the drugs you are going to prescribe, what frequency and what route. If you do that, it will impress your examiner, you are a caring doctor. And similarly, hydration and nutrition. Because such patients may not eat or drink for quite a few days, 4 or 5 days, then TPN. If you mention these things, examiner will like it. And after the post-operative care, she'll need follow-up treatment. If it was, let's say, stage 1 endometrial carcinoma, which had not invaded endometrium, you can say, may not need any radiotherapy, needs only follow-up. Our patient has stage 4, so she will need radiotherapy. And permanent follow-up. Here, I don't know, remember the figure, but you go home and study stage 4 survival rate. It is 20%.
10 to 15%.
So tell examiner that she will like it, that after surgery, radiotherapy, in spite of moderate treatment, her 5-year survival rate is likely to be 10 to 15% limited.
If it's type 2, then the survival rate is further.
Yes. Oh, the stage 1 se shuru kar le, start stage 1, they have excellent survival.
In clear cell carcinoma and sir, clear cell carcinoma, the survival rate is further reduced as compared to sir adenocarcinoma.
Sure. So if you say that and you manage to say this before the bell goes, you will pass. Very good.
Sir?
You pass.
Sir, agar ek patient isi tarah same yahi history patient yahi symptoms and postmenopausal bleeding patient present kiye, TBS findings bhi suggestive hai, clinically bhi wo suggestive hai malignancy ke, MRI pe invasion bhi hai, lymph node involvement bhi hai. Sir, biopsy nahi hui bhi patient MRI leke aayi. So, sir, directly, can we go first?
Yeah, bada achha sawal.
Yeah,
good question. That here is a patient where postmenopausal bleeding and ultrasound or MRI or anything shows there is a growth inside the uterine cavity. The lady is asking whether we still should do biopsy of that tumor or bypass biopsy, go straight away for surgical treatment or hysterectomy. In examination, you will do biopsy.
Sir, even benign cheese invasive to nahi ho sakti, agar
invasion MRI pe. Even then, you will do biopsy.
We must know the histopathology, grading of the tumor, sir. That is very important.
She has added to my answer,
yes,
that for the purpose of not only making a diagnosis, is grading, and further management will depend upon that as well. So biopsy is a must. Thank you.